Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this evening episode of Pursue. Today it's Pursue 4E Gyne Path, and this is the last of the series of lecture in gyne pathology. And today's topic is quite vast. We have neoplastic and non-neoplastic lesions of the fallopian tube. We have then the gestational trophoblastic tumor, and then also there'll be a small talk on the mesenchymal lesions of the body of uterus. And to speak on this, we have Colonel Dr. Tanushree Mukherjee. She is a professor in the Department of Pathology, Command Hospital, Kolkata, trained in oncopathology and affiliate member of the Royal College of Pathologists, London. Before I ask ma'am to take over, let me request everyone to please keep your mic muted, your camera off, and please don't share your screen. With this, let me request ma'am, please take over and share your screen, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. The topic, first I will cover the remnants like the mesenchymal tumor and mesenchymal tumor of the uterus, because the other tumors we have already discussed, the fallopian tube, the non-neoplastic and neoplastic lesions, and the gestational trophoblastic diseases, including the gestational trophoblastic tumor. So the uterus mesenchymal lesions, the spectrum, it includes the smooth muscle tumor, the stromal tumor, and the other mesenchymal tumor.
We can't see your screen, ma'am. We can't see your screen. No. I think you have to share your PPT. I mean, it's not coming.
But it is like a soft.
No, not at all.
Hello?
No, not yet, ma'am.
No?
Not yet, no.
Okay.
Yeah, just wait, it's coming. Just please wait. No, it's not. Still not there. It was coming and then it didn't come. You stop sharing your screen. Please share your screen again. You can do one thing, you can just log out and then come in again and then try to do it. Just exit from the Google Meet and then join in again. Yeah, now try to share, because I was just sharing in between to see if it's all right or not. Just share now.
Yeah, coming?
Not yet. No, ma'am, we can't see your screen. Just press present now. your entire screen and then go to the
entire screen.
And then share.
Can you see the screen? Hello?
No, ma'am, we can't see your screen. Your voice is getting disconnected in between, but we just wait. Let me see. No, it's not coming. Is there any network problem on your end?
No, the Wi-Fi is perfectly okay.
Yeah, no, please share your presentation, ma'am. Please share your presentation from the below, from the lower taskbar. Just press on the PowerPoint. Yeah, I can see it now. Please make it full screen.
Okay. Yeah, full screen.
Yeah, it's perfectly fine. Just remove that hide button thing. Pop up. Yeah, you can just remove that hide thing. Yeah, fine. Again, it's gone. Anyway, come back again, ma'am. Please, you come share your screen again from the taskbar. Yes. Yeah. I think you have to share your PowerPoint. You're sharing your Google screen.
Yeah.
Yeah, fine. Just make it full screen, please.
Make full screen.
No, it's not. Full screen yet.
Full screen.
Yeah, now it's okay. Fine, ma'am. Please go ahead. Yeah, it's fine.
Okay.
Please.
Sorry, there's some technical error. Okay. So the topic I will cover the mesenchymal tumors of the uterus, fallopian tube, the non-neoplastic and the neoplastic lesions, and the gestational trophoblastic diseases, including the gestational trophoblastic tumors. So the uterus. The mesenchymal lesion, the spectrum is the smooth muscle tumor, the stromal tumor, and the other mesenchymal tumors. The smooth muscle tumors, the very common neomyoma. Then there are other variants like the apoplectic neomyoma, benign metastasizing leomyoma, leomyoma with bizarre nuclei, cellular leomyoma, dissecting leomyoma, epithelioid leomyoma. Then there's an entity called ephemeric hydratase deficient leomyoma, hydropic, intravenous, mitotically active, myxoid leomyoma, smooth muscle tumors of uncertain malignant potential, and leomyosarcoma. Then the stromal tumors, endometrial stromal neoplasm, endometrial stromal nodule, high-grade and low-grade endometrial stromal sarcoma. Then the other mesenchymal tumors, which are the perivascular epithelioid cell tumor, the intramammary fibroblastic tumor, and the undifferentiated sarcomas. So leomyomas, atypical leomyoma, leomyosarcoma, algorithm, and approach based upon the ATPR, the mitotic figure, and the necrosis. No or mild ATPR, no tumor cell necrosis, leomyoma. Moderate to severe ATPR, no tumor cell necrosis, atypical leomyoma. If less than 10 mitotic figures per 10 hyperfield, or leomyosarcoma is 10 mitotic figures per 10 hyperfield. Moderate to severe ATPR and tumor cell necrosis, leomyosarcoma. And mitotic figures don't matter. So this is the algorithm, it should be followed. And the stromal tumor of uncertain malignant potential, minimally atypical smooth muscle neoplasm with a low mitotic index, but with uncertainty about the histologic type. Standard leiomyoma versus a myxoid, or standard versus epithelioid, combinations, when it is a stromal tumor of uncertain malignant potential or undetermined malignant potential. So this is a leiomyoma, extremely common tumor, maybe due to xenoestrogens, somatic mutations, X chromosome, aberration, meat consumption may be a risk factor, and green vegetables a protective factor. Typically asymptomatic, but it can cause abnormal uterine bleeding. Difficult to diagnose in GNC specimen since resembles superficial myomectomy. It's symptomatic, it is myomectomy, neutralized acetate depot, or GnRH analog. Grossly, sharply circumscribed, round, firm, grayish white, raw cell, and world cut surface. World pattern of smooth muscle bundles separated by well vascularized connective tissue. Non infiltrative growth with thick walled arteries throughout. That's how you differentiate it from the normal myometrium. And cleft like spaces are there. May have extensive hyaline necrosis if protrudes into endometrial cavity. Usually less than 5 mitotic figures per 10 high power C. In most mitotically active area, no significant atypia. If it is on treatment, initially edema and necrosis, then hydrolyzation and mild lymphocytic infiltrate can be seen. The type, apoplastic leiomyoma, benign metastasizing leiomyoma, leiomyoma with bizarre nuclei, cellular leiomyoma dissecting epithelioid. When there is a fumarate hydratase deficient leiomyoma, heterozygous germline mutations in fumarate hydratase predispose the multiple cutaneous and uterine leiomyomatosis syndrome, which when coexisting with renal cancer is also known as hereditary leiomyomatosis and renal cell cancer. Most muscle proliferations with unusual growth patterns could be disseminated peritoneal leiomyomatosis, benign metastasizing leiomyoma, intravenous leiomyomatosis, and lymphangeal leiomatosis. The positive stain is not required, but sometimes if it is like you atypical and you have to differentiate smooth muscle actin, desmin, HCAL desmon, focal cytokeratin, occasionally focal CD10, and the differential diagnosis are endometrial stromal sarcoma with smooth muscle metaplasia, leiomyosarcoma. Then, some smooth muscle tumor of uncertain malignant potential. There is a criteria for the problematic smooth muscle uterine tumors that cannot be histologically diagnosed as unequivocally benign or malignant. Criteria do not apply to the extrauterine tumor. Must rigidly apply following criteria for atypia, mitotic figures, and coagulated tumor cell necrosis. So, based upon the atypia, mitotic figures, and necrosis, the differentiation is done between the benign tumor, the stem, and a leiomyosarcoma. So here the cutoff point, what you see in the mitotic figure, there are hairy extensions of chromatin must be present, extending from a central clot-like dense mass of chromosomes, hair extensions from an empty center favor a non-mitosis. 4 sets of 10 fields in areas of highest mitotic activity and use the highest count. No nuclear membrane. Count only definite mitotic figures and severe atypia and necrosis presence or absence is a powerful predictor of outcome with for patients with uterine smooth muscle tumor. Then comes the leiomyosarcoma. It is a rare tumor derived from smooth muscle, most common uterine sarcoma. It is a de novo tumor, 3 types, spindle, conventional, epithelioid and myxoid. Spindle is the conventional type, okay? In triad of histologic features, severe atypia, increased mitosis and tumor cell necrosis, poor prognosis and limited therapeutic options. Very rare cases arise with pre-existing leiomyoma, usually discovered incidentally during hysterectomy for fibroids. Abnormal adrenal bleeding may be present. Grossly bulky fleshy tumor invading into the myometrial wall or polypoid tumor projecting into the lumen, often hemorrhagic or necrotic. Grossly appears invasive or infiltrative, very large with mean diameter of 10 cm. Myxoid leiomyosarcoma may have gelatinous cut surface. Microscopically, as I said, conventional or spindles. There is severe atypia, mass cellular atypia, more than 10 mitosis per 10 high power fields, and tumor cell necrosis. And myxoid leiomyosarcoma, presence of pathologic atypia, tumor cell necrosis, or more than 1 mitosis per 10 high power field. And epithelioid leiomyosarcoma, presence of moderate to severe pathologic atypia, a tumor cell necrosis, or more than 4 mitosis per 10 high power field. Tumor cells arranged in sheets and they are round the polygonal cells with eosinophilic or clear cytoplasm. Prognostic, even with tumor confined to uterus, it is considered as aggressive. And the treatment is total abdominal hysterectomy, bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy for postmenopausal females and those with metastatic disease. Positive stain, all the smooth muscle markers, chalcedon, desmine, SMA. Negative stain, HMG-45, because it is epithelioid, differentiated from melanoma. So, HMG-45, then ALK, melane, it is done for differentiating it from some peculiar tumors. Some molecular aberrations are there, P53, ATRS, MBD12, then NR4HG, PGR fusion, PGR rearrangement. Class 1 rearrangements have been seen in myxoid leiomyosarcoma. Then the stromal tumors, this is the second category, uterine tumors of endometrial stromal derivation, presence of permeative infiltrative growth into the myometrium or lymphovascular spaces, which clinically reflects its behavior and alters the therapy. Benign and low-grade lesions, endometrial stromal nodules. Then sarcomas are the low-grade endometrial stromal sarcoma and high-grade endometrial stromal sarcoma. Represents the second most common category of uterine mesenchymal tumors, genetic alterations, RAS-F1-12 changes, decor alterations. When invasion cannot be assessed in a biopsy, it is recommended to report as endometrial stromal tumor and defer the definitive classification to the hysterectomy specimen. CD10 is positive in the cells. There's a small blue cell with scant cytoplasm and low mitotic activity. First described by Norris and Taylor as endolymphatic stromal meiosis for low grade and stromal sarcoma for high grade. So, endometrial stromal nodules, no or minimal myoinvasion, less than 3 millimeters, less than 3 protrusions in number, no lymphovascular invasion. Endometrial stromal tumor with limited infiltration. Endometrial stromal sarcoma, endometrial stromal nodule with myometrial or lymphovascular invasion. And high-grade endometrial sarcoma with variable morphology, high-grade sarcoma not otherwise specified subgrouping by morphology, combination of low-grade and high-grade components may be seen. So genetic alterations, as I have said, it can be seen in the undifferentiated endometrial stromal sarcoma, the YWHAE-FAM22. Grossly polypoid or intramural with a fleshy tan yellow cut surface, high grade frequently shows grossly evident myometrial invasion. Necrosis, hemorrhage in high grade tumors. Low grade microscopically consists of well differentiated endometrial stromal cells exhibiting only mild nuclear atypia and infiltrates the myometrium as irregular chunks, often with lymphovascular invasion. Low mitotic activity, usually less than 5 per 10 high power field. the smooth muscle differentiation, pyramidoid chain, sex cord-like differentiation, and endometrioid-like glands may be present. The high-grade type, high-grade round cells sometimes associated with the low-grade spindly component. Mitotic activity is more than 10 per 10 high power field. Necrosis is present. Then there can be the undifferentiated endometrial sarcomas. So you have to resort to the IHC, CD10, smooth muscle actin, ER, PR, cyclin D1, C-kit, or CD117, and negative stain for S-cal-desmon and desmin, which are used for the marker of leiomyosarcoma. Differential diagnosis are many. It could be starting from a polyp to a uterine tumor resembling ovarian sex cord tumors, so you have to resort to IHC. Then the perivascular epitheloid cell tumor is an entity, abdominopelvic sarcoma of perivascular epitheloid cells, or a primary extrapulmonary sugar tumor test. Rare mesenchymal neoplasm with myomelanocytic differentiation favors to arise from perivascular epitheloid cells. Tumor of uncertain malignant potential as recurrences may occur years after initial diagnosis. Clear to eosinophilic epitheloid or spindle cells growing in sheaths, nests or cords and surrounded by delicate vasculature. It expresses both melanoma like HMB45, melanin, and smooth muscle markers, which can be desmin and skeldesmon. 10% are associated with tuberous sclerosis complex. It occurs in the uterine corpus, but cervix, vagina, ovary, and other sites can be included. Three algorithms have been proposed for predicting the behavior based upon the infiltration, mitosis, necrosis, and lymphovascular invasion. So, benign, oblique, uncertain malignant potential, and malignant. Recurrence can occur years after original diagnosis. Treatment is surgery, grossly variable, and resembles other mesenchymal lesions, typically intramural but may be polypoid. Tan, white, or gray solid mass. Microscopically, most are myo-invasive, shows permeative tongue-like growth, numerous growth patterns including sheaths, nests, cords, trabeculae, pseudoalveoli, and fascicles. Melanoma-like nucleoli, intranuclear pseudo-infusion. HMD45 is positive. Cathepsin C is a recently identified domino stain that has been expressed in all sarcomas. So to summarize, the mesenchymal tumors, smooth muscle tumors, leiomyoma, the variant, cellular, leiomyoma with bizarre nuclei, mitotically active leiomyoma can stump the smooth muscle tumor of uncertain malignant potential, leiomyosarcoma, malignant smooth muscle tumor, typically spindle cell but can be epithelioid, then endometrial stromal tumor, endometrial stromal nodule, it's a benign tumor, resembling proliferative endometrial stroma with a relatively well-circumscribed margin, low-grade endometrial stromal sarcoma, and high-grade endometrial stromal sarcoma. Other tumors, undifferentiated uterine sarcoma. Then, uterine tumor resembling ovarian sex cord tumor, rhabdomyosarcoma, perivascular epitheloid cell tumor, inflammatory myofibroblastic tumor, cells spindly growing in fascicles, ALK1 is positive, then tumors with a glandular component like a carcinosarcoma, dysphagic tumor, adenosarcoma, and adenomatoid tumor, which I will discuss along with the fallopian tube tumor. It's a benign tumor of mesothelial origin. Some of the biphagic and the adenomyomas and the adenosarcomas, this photomicrograph I am showing. So this I will complete the mesenchymal tumor and start the fallopian tube. The normal fallopian tube, gross, and how it develops. The non-neoplastic lesions, which could include the metaplasia, hyperplasia, simple cysts, the paratubal lesions, the adrenal rest, then the ectopic pregnancy, some entities like cell telangiectasis, ischemica, nodosa, then the congenital anomalies, then the neoplasms, which include the benign and the malignant neoplasms. fallopian tube, named after the discoverer of the 16th century Italian anatomist Gabriel Fallopio. Ovidius, uterine tube, Salpingus. Salpingus means trumpet. Embryology, third week, migration of primordial germ cells from yolk sac. Genital ridge forms from intermediate mesoderm, cloaca forms. Fourth week, Mullerian dust forms from coelomic epithelium, invaginating ventrolaterally into Wolfian duct and genital mesentery. Fifth to eighth week, amphioscapalic part of Mullerian duct forms the fallopian tube, and tube part forms uterus and upper vagina. Grossly hollow tubular structure, then arterial supply from branches of uterine and ovarian arteries, segment intramural within wall of uterus, isthmus thick walled, ampulla thin walled, infundibulum end line wise, fimbriae attaches to ovary. Tubal ostium opening to peritoneal cavity, uterotubal junction entrance to uterine cavity. Microscopically, slice delicate folds of mucosa on inner aspect of tube, most evident in ampulla as seen in the photomicrograph above. In the mucosa, the tubal fluid, the muscle layer, three smooth muscle layers, innermost is oblique and middle and outer, serosal surface, mesothelium of visceral peritoneum, stroma is there. Then the histological variation. Like the lower photomicrograph, you see it is from the isthmic part. Then the intramuscular edema and postpartum changes could be there. There could be fibrosis, there could be tough stain, there could be some inflammatory infiltrate, normal histological variation. One the common thing which we see, ectopic tubal pregnancy or ecchymosis, implantation of fertilized egg within the fallopian tube due to various risk factors like tubal damage, pelvic inflammatory disease, previous ectopics, commonly in the ampulla in 80% of the cases. When salpingectomy is done to see that confirmation of the ectopic, distension of the tube with thin or ruptured wall, dusty red serosa and hematocelling. Microscopically, intraluminal chorionic villi and extravillous trophoblasts and variable fetal parts can be seen. And the metaplasias can occur in the tube, or alteration in which the normal tubal epithelium is replaced by metaplastic cells resembling benign transitional cells of urinary bladder, transitional cell metaplasia. And it is present in 26% of all the specimens. Distal fallopian tube or fimbriae are the commonly affected. Etiology is not clear. Diagnosis is only possible after salpingectomy is done and microscopic examination is done. Clinically, no biological significance, but yes, because you have to differentiate it, so it is important you recognize the metaplasia. Grossly, you can't detect it. Microscopically, most commonly mucinous metaplasia and urothelial and squamous metaplasia also can be seen. Sometimes you have to resort to Ki-67 or Ki-53 to differentiate diagnosis from serous tubal lesions of uncertain significance or serous tubal intraepithelial carcinoma. Then salpingitis isthmica nodosa or diverticulosis of the fallopian tube. Fallopian tube epithelium outpouching into tubal wall. In severe cases, lumen may be completely obstructed. May be analogous to uterine adenomyosis associated with infertility in 50%. Usually well delineated yellow-white nodular swelling. Microscopically, regularly spaced glands lined by normal appearing tubal epithelium within hypertrophic smooth muscle or surrounding fibrous tissue. Glands may be cystically dilated and are true diverticula that communicate with tubal lumen. Then, various signs of acute and chronic salpingitis and physiologic salpingitis, mild amount of acute inflammation, is present in the vascular spaces, in the tubo-ovarian abscess, and in the hydrocele thing. There's a spectrum from acute to chronic and granulomatous, and then you can see here the granulomatous salpingitis due to pinworm. It could be a pseudoxanthomatous salpingitis or a xanthogranulomatous salpingitis. In which you can see loss of foamy kind macrophages with accompanying lymphocytes, grossly enlarged distorted tube adherent to ovary, may be associated with hydrosulfing or pyosulfing that transforms the tubo-ovarian cyst. Microscopically, blunted, shortened fibrotic plicate contain chronic inflammatory cells, chronic follicular salpingitis that may resemble malignancy or a pseudoxanthomatous change, because you can confuse it with malacoplasia also sometimes. Now the tumors of the fallopian tube, the epithelial tumors and cysts, tumor-like lesions as said, metaplasia, endometriosis, endosalpingiosis, tubal hyperplasia, then the benign epithelial tumors, the papilloma, serous adenofibroma, an epithelial precursor lesion, serous tubal intraepithelial carcinoma stick, then epithelial borderline tumor, the malignant epithelial tumors, which includes low-grade serous, high-grade serous. As I told in the class for the ovary, that the precursor of the ovarian lesions could be on the fallopian tube only. And then the mixed epithelial mesenchymal tumors, mesenchymal tumors, leiomyoma, leiomyosarcoma, an adenomatoid tumor, very common mesothelial tumor, and the germ cell tumor. This is the most common benign fallopian tube tumor, adenomatoid tumor, asymptomatic, also called as benign mesothelioma, occurs in middle-aged or older females due to invagination of visceral mesothelium. Grossly incidental discovery, microscopic finding within myosulfing. Microscopically, tubular spaces of varying size composed of flattened cells resembling endothelium. Cells at the name WT1 D240 thrombomodulin is positive. Differential diagnosis could be an adenomyoma, lymphangioma. And these are the various lesions like the cyst, paratubal cyst, then the papillomas, metastatic papillary tumor or adenofibroma, the spectrum of tumors which can be found benign as well as malignant. This is a lesion which we must differentiate and recognize. It is a serous tubal intraepithelial carcinoma or secretory cell outgrowth, SCOUT. Secretory cell expansion with variable ciliation, P53 signature, or serous tubal intraepithelial lesion still, or secretory cell outgrowth with strong P53 staining. Histology could be normal. Lesion limited to the fallopian tube epithelium, that is a precursor to extrauterine pelvic high-grade serous carcinoma. It is confined to the epithelium. Patients with hereditary BRCA mutation have a high risk of ovarian serous cancer, and so is this entity. Fallopian tube fimbria is the most common site of origin. Secretory epithelium is possibly the cell of origin. It is discovered incidentally and examination is required. The grossing protocol is important. Amputation and longitudinal sectioning of the infundibulum and fimbrial segment distal 2 cm allows maximal exposure of the tubal plicate. Isthmus and ampullae are cut transversely at 2 to 3 mm intervals. Entire fallopian tube should be submitted for evaluation in women with BRCA mutations or a strong family history of ovarian carcinoma. Extensively examine the fimbriated end. So the grossing will be same like for an ovarian tumor, but the grossing protocol for the fallopian tube should be done like this, and I will not cover the grossing again. So this should be stressed here. Treatment, no current consensus among gynecologists regarding appropriate management. Patients have been managed by surgical staging, peritoneal washing, chemotherapy or follow-up without additional intervention. Grossly, nothing is evident. Microscopically, epithelial stratification, lack of ciliated cells, high NC ratio, basophilic appearance of the cells, nucleophilomorphism, loss of polarity. Positive stain, P53 positive, Ki-67 index high. You can see the photomicrograph, IHC showing P53 positivity. Differential diagnosis, P53 signature, lesions which appears benign and lacks ATPR with P53 positive immunostain and the metaplasia. Then high grade serous carcinoma, high stage with pelvic extension or positive peritoneal cytology, Sukkot primary in fallopian tube, should arise from mucosa, endosulfan, has tubal origin, involve the lumen, uterus and ovaries must be normal or have foci of malignancy that resemble metastasis or independent primaries. Tubes enlarged with solid or papillary tumor filling the lumen. Microscopically, invasive papillary adenocarcinoma may resemble ovarian serous adenocarcinoma with complex papillary architecture. Then other tumors, peculiar tumors, female adnexal tumor of Wolffian origin, open tubules, closed elongated tubules and sieve-like pattern. And this is a papillary cystadenoma associated with Von Hippel Lindau disease of the fallopian tube. This is a follicular lymphoma, just I'm showing the photograph. Some peculiar tumors which are not very common, and so fallopian tube can have this kind of lesion. So this is the TNM and FIGO classification of tumors of the ovary fallopian tube. So you know that when the tumor is limited to one ovary or fallopian tube, which is 1A, and then you follow and compare the FIGO with the TNM here. Then the gestational trophoblastic diseases. So it includes the first the morphology, development, and the functional aspects of trophoblasts. The types of trophoblasts you must be able to recognize, and the IHC done in that. Then the classification of the gestational trophoblastic diseases, and about the mole, the complete hereditary mole, partial mole, invasive mole, and then the tumors, and then IHC approach. So this is the formation of the chorion nuclei. At 3 weeks of gestation, the entire blastocyst embedded in the endometrium at the implantation site. This is very important because you have to understand at the intervillous stage, chorionic villi degenerate, and at 17 weeks of gestation, the uterine is largely obliterated, and the amnion and chorion levy become opposed to the endometrium, the opposite side of the uterine cavity, and the chorion levy, amnion and the underlying decidua constitute the fetal membrane. So, the abnormal trophoblastic tissue in gestational trophoblastic disease recapitulates the trophoblast present in the early developing placenta and the implantation site. In normal placentation, the trophoblast growing in association with chorionic villi is referred to as villous trophoblast. Whereas a trophoblast in all other locations is from extravillous trophoblast. Three distinct types of trophoblast cells have been recognized: cytotrophoblast, thin tissue trophoblast, and intermediate trophoblast. Villous trophoblast is composed of cytotrophoblast and thin tissue trophoblast, a small amount of intermediate trophoblast. In contrast, extravillous trophoblast that infiltrates the decidua, myometrium, and spiral arteries of the placental type is composed of intermediate trophoblast. Cytotrophoblast is a germinative component of trophoblast, and thin tissue trophoblast is a differentiated component that interferes with the maternal circulation and produces most of the placental hormones. After the development of the chorionic villi, distinctive trophoblastic subpopulations can be recognized. The chorionic villous surface is lined by a continuous inner layer of cytotrophoblast and an outer layer of thin tissue trophoblast. Cytotrophoblast is a trophoblastic stem cell on the villous surface. Proliferating activity with a Ki-67 nuclear labeling index of approximately 30% in the first trimester. On the villous surface, The cytotrophoblast fuses directly to form the syncytiotrophoblast. So, the dimorphic pattern of pre-villous trophoblast is reminiscent of the dimorphic pattern of trophoblast in choriocarcinoma, and morphologic appearance of choriocarcinoma is a recapitulation of the appearance of the pre-villous trophoblast. Cytotrophoblast, following the development of villi, cytotrophoblastic cells appear in small, primitive epithelial cells, uniform and polygonal, single nucleus, clear to granular cytoplasm and well-defined cell borders. Mitotic activity is evident. Syncytia, large multinucleated cellular mass with dense amphiphilic cytoplasm, often containing multiple vacuoles. So please see this clearly, because many times there's confusion. You have to identify cytotrophoblasts. They're the single nucleus clear to granular cytoplasm. And syncytia, large multinucleated cellular mass. This is a chorionic villus and the implantation site. Anchoring villus attaches to the implantation site. The villus is outlined by two trophoblastic layers, the inner cytotrophoblast and the outer syncytiotrophoblast. The intermediate trophoblast differentiates from the trophoblastic column and emanates from the distal column to the implantation site. Although multinucleate implantation site intermediate trophoblastic cells can be seen in trophoblastic neoplasm, such as placental site trophoblastic tumor, they are more frequently encountered in the normal or exaggerated placental site, a helpful morphological feature in distinguishing exaggerated placental site from placental site trophoblastic tumor. Another pattern that distinguishes non-neoplastic trophoblastic cells from tumor cells is their pattern of cellular proliferation. So any proliferative activity in the implantation site should be considered as abnormal in the intermediate trophoblast. This is the IHC expression of the cytotrophoblast, syncytiotrophoblast, and the intermediate trophoblast in trophoblastic column, implantation site, and chorionic liver. CD146 is a synonym of MELCAM. So you see here, and the dark red is a strong expression. M which is seen in multinucleated intermediate trophoblast. So cytotrophoblast, we've seen that it is positive for cyclin E, P63, and beta catenin. Syncytia for human placental lactogen and beta HCG. So the diseases, the gestational trophoblastic diseases, the molar pregnancies include complete mole, partial mole, invasive mole, and the abnormal non-molar villous lesions. The non-neoplastic lesions like the exaggerated placental site and placental site nodule and plaque, and neoplasm, choriocarcinoma, placental site trophoblastic tumor, and epithelioid trophoblastic tumor. So please remember this WHO classification, then the understanding is easy. And this is the TNM and the PIGO classification. Confined to uterus, extends to the genital structures, met to lung, it is M1A and M1B is distant metastasis. Then the molar pregnancies, hydrogen mole, complete mole, partial mole, and invasive mole. Risk factor, prior mole, primary gravid state, Asian, African, Latin American. Extremes of reproductive age and vitamin A precursor deficiency. H mole is an abnormal placenta characterized by enlarged edematous and vesicular chorionic villi accompanied by villous trophoblastic hyperplasia. Complete and partial. Surgical curettage is the preferred method of treatment. All molar pregnancies have the potential for persistent gestational trophoblastic diseases. If the diagnostic features, metabulated form, complete mole, the partial mole, and the clinical presentation, pre-treatment levels, ultrasound, macroscopy, chorionic villi. It is present, complete nole, diffuse enlargement. I will describe them separately. The tropoblastic hyperplasia, cytologic atypia, villous stroma, cistern formation, seen in complete mole, and P57 immunostain, which is seen in partial mole. And very early complete mole is the entity in between. You can see here some genetic DNA genotyping differences are there. Diploid diandric in complete mole, diploid diandric in very early complete mole, H-mole, and there is a triploid diandric monogynic genome in partial mole. So complete mole, proliferative disorder of the placenta, villous hydrops, and tropoblastic hyperplasia without embryonic development. Diploid paternal only genome. So the see the chromosomal origin of a complete mole is 46XX. Ultrasonography shows characteristic no-stop appearance. 90% of complete moles are 46XX. Vaginal bleeding with passage of grape-like vesicles is a common presentation. Disproportionately large uterus. 50% of patients with complete moles at HCG levels of 1 lakh MIU per ml. This is a prognostic factor pre-evacuation level, and then it is follow up with the HCG level after the evacuation. Suction evacuation with curettage is done. Grossly bulky bloody tissue with hydrophic stinges in all villi. Semi-transparent vesicles of variable size, bunch of grit. Microscopically, diffuse villous enlargement with mild hydrophic changes, cistern formation, bulbous tropoblastic hyperplasia in a circumferential pattern. So cistern formation, the distended core of the villus traversed by widely separated broken strands of fibrillar material. This is very characteristic. Stromal changes of molar villi, which includes stromal mucin and stromal nuclear debris, appear very early and represent a diagnostic tool. Stain P53, beta-HCG, plus HPL. P57 is negative. So karyotype, you please remember, it is 46XX. Partial mole, the chromosomal origin, a normal egg, but the 23X haploid sex is fertilized by two sperms that carry either sex chromosome to result in 69 chromosomes with a sex configuration XXY, XXX or XYI. So, the resulting main differential diagnosis includes the complete mole. So, here it's a complete mole is 57 negative and diandric diploid genotype. Here it is paternal genome and it is a 57 positive. This abnormal chorionic villi characterized by spectrum of villous population ranging from a normal size to substantial enlargement, irregular contours and mild or focal tropoblastic hyperplasia. It results from fertilization of a normal egg by two sperms or by one sperm followed by duplication of the paternal chromosomal component. Risk factors include advanced maternal age and previous history of molar pregnancy. It can present with myths of spontaneous abortion. So clinical laboratory and imaging data with lab beta-HCG, inhibin and activin A. Elevated beta-HCG levels follow up. Prognostic factor, risk of persistent gestational tropoblastic disease. Treatment, evacuation and curettage. Grossly, immature placental tissue admixed with vesicles that tend to be smaller and less numerous than those of a complete mole. Microscopically, heterogeneity in villus size with two discrete populations of villi, large hydrophic villi and small fibrotic villi. Cistern formation can be seen in enlarged villi, circumferential mild tropoblastic hyperplasia. This is a photomicrograph of a partial mole with tropoblastic mild hyperplasia and syncytial tropoblastic knuckles of sprouts. contains, as I said, 357 positivity, then the flow cytometry and genotyping could be done, and differential diagnosis between the complete mole, hydropic spontaneous abortion, and Beckwith-Wiedemann syndrome. Then the invasive mole, most common form of persistent or metastatic trophoblastic disease after H mole, occurs 6 to 10 times more frequently than choriocarcinoma. Defined as molar gestation invading the myometrium or uterine vessels, commonly present with vaginal bleeding and persistent elevation of beta HCG. Commonly diagnosed after primary evacuation of complete or partial mole. Chemotherapy is highly effective. Hydropic villi are visible, extending from the endometrium into the myometrium. Perforation of uterus can occur. And microscopically abnormal chorionic villi and extravellous trophoblasts invade the myometrium and blood vessels. Differential diagnosis, choriocarcinoma and placenta accreta. This is the PIGO or WHO scoring system of prognostic and predictive parameters for trophoblastic tumors. Based upon the age, antecedent pregnancy, then pre-treatment beta HCG, tumor size, site of metastasis. Exaggerated placental site. This is an exuberant infiltration of myometrium by implantation site intermediate trophoblast. Microscopically, it can be seen an implantation site intermediate trophoblast from multinucleated giant cells. Smooth muscle cells of myometrium are separated by cords, nests, and individual trophoblastic cells that diffusely infiltrate the myometrium. Chorionic villi are morphologically unremarkable. And this is a placental site nodules or clasps, small and well circumscribed nodular aggregates of intermediate trophoblastic cells embedded in a hyalinized stroma. Clinically discovered incidentally, placental site nodules are small lesions which appear as yellow, white and necrotic nodule in the endometrium. Microscopically, small nodular or clasp-like lesions with rounded, well circumscribed borders which are surrounded by chronic inflammatory cells and occasionally deschedulite stoma. Ki-67 proliferation is low in this. So this is a placental site nodule. Positive stain could be CK18, EMA, then inhibin A, P63. Differential diagnosis includes the epithelioid trophoblastic tumor. Then the placental site trophoblastic tumor, a neoplasm of implantation site intermediate trophoblastic cell, is a rare form of gestational trophoblastic disease. Other previously used terms like atypical choriocarcinoma, syncytioma, chorioepitheliosis, trophoblastic pseudotumor. Prognostic factor, independent predictors of poor prognosis, advanced PIGO stage, antecedent pregnancy, presence of tumor cells with clear cytoplasm, depth of invasion, tumor size, necrosis, high mitosis. Microscopically, the placental site trophoblastic tumor consists of sheets of polygonal to spindle intermediate trophoblastic cell with irregular hyperchromatic nuclei and eosinophilic cytoplasm. The presence of abundant extracellular eosinophilic fibroid material and invasion of blood vessels and displacement of the vessel walls of myometrium is the characteristic feature of the placental site trophoblastic tumor. And the differential diagnosis are many, like choriocarcinoma or epithelioid trophoblastic tumor or the exaggerated placental site tumor or a melanoma or a molar gestation. Treatment is hysterectomy is curative in most of the cases. Then one entity is the epithelioid trophoblastic tumor. It is a rare, again, common location, uterus, cervix. It exhibits slow growth, remain confined to the uterus. And the cells are the classical here. Mitotic count of more than 6 per 10 high power field of N-fibril prodrome spectrum. Treatment stage 1 disease is treated with hysterectomy. Grossly discrete nodules for cystic hemorrhagic masses deeply infiltrate the surrounding structure. microscopically nodular and well circumscribed, focally infiltrative at the periphery. Tumor cells are relatively uniform, mononucleate, arranged in nests and cords. And the epithelioid tumor cells are present. Then the choriocarcinoma, malignant trophoblastic tumor, trimorphic proliferation of syncytial trophoblasts, cytotrophoblasts and intermediate trophoblasts with absence of chorionic villi. Most aggressive form of gestational trophoblastic disease. It is rapidly invasive with early hematogenous metastasis. 50% are diagnosed following a term pregnancy. Complete mole may progress to choriocarcinoma in some cases. Risk factors are prior HMOL, ethnicity, advanced maternal age, long-term oral contraceptive use. For clinical features, medial bleeding, then untreated, it causes metastasis. Metastasis is clinically solitary and may occur in unusual locations. This is a positive immunostain, HLA G63 inhibin cyclin E, negative beta HCG. Most tumors have no Y chromosome complement. Differential diagnosis, atypical placental site nodule, then placental site nodule, placental site trophoblastic tumors. Lab findings, serum and urine HCG. Prognostic score is calculated based on the age, antecedent pregnancy, as I showed in the FIGO chart. Treatment based on the FIGO chart, low risk, high risk, and cranial met. Low risk, single chemotherapy agent, methotrexate or actinomycin, high risk, intensive combination chemotherapy. Grossly, bulky, destructive, single to multiple dark masses in uterus, extensive central hemorrhage, variable amount of necrosis. Microscopically, tumor may be diffusely infiltrative or may have cohesive seeds of trimorphic malignant trophoblasts consisting of intermediate trophoblasts and cytotrophoblasts trimmed with syncytial trophoblasts, presence of marked central hemorrhage and necrosis, striking cytologic atypia and numerous mitotic figures. Lymphovascular invasion is common. Characteristically, there is absence of chorionic villi. Presence of villi excludes choriocarcinoma. This is a positive stain. And the electron microscopy can be done, and the molecular features and the differential diagnosis. This is the diagnostic criteria for a choriocarcinoma, the placental cytotrophoblastic tumor, and epithelioid trophoblastic tumor. These are my references. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Extensive coverage, must be tired by now. Especially the trophoblastic tumors are so difficult.
First know the basics of the trophoblast and then only you can proceed with the molar pregnancies and the tumor.
Yeah, that's right. It's very nicely presented and thank you so much. I think that completes our entire gynae pathology. I would like to thank you. So you've taken a lot of effort for that. Thank you so much, ma'am. We'll get back to you for something more soon.
Thank you.
Thank you. Take care. Bye-bye.
Thank you.